Welcome all of you. I'm Rosalind Mishra. Welcome to a class of Pharmaceutical Inorganic Chemistry. So today's topic shall be, as you can see on the board here, poison and antidote. Our today's topic would be poison and antidote, about which we shall be learning about poison first, and then we would see the different types of antidotes. Well, our university expects from us to learn about three major antidotes, which is sodium thiosulfate, activated charcoal, and sodium nitrate. Sodium thiosulfate, activated charcoal, and sodium nitrite. Okay, so we shall be dealing with each of these drugs in detail. Apart from that, first we shall see about poison, and then we will learn about antidotes. What are poison? What is meant by poison? A very common terminology, I'm sure. Still, we shall learn about it again. Okay. Poison is defined as a substance which, when administered, inhaled, or swallowed, is capable of acting deleteriously on the body. Okay. Poison is any foreign substance which, when administered or inhaled or swallowed, is capable of acting deleteriously on the body. It has got adverse effect on the body. That is, they produce ill health or sometimes might also lead to death. Classification of poison include, based on the action, poison can be classified into 6 categories. Based on their action or based on their mode of action, poison can be classified into 6 categories. Number 1, corrosives. Corrosives, that is, they are corrosive towards the tissues or cells. Irritants, neurotoxic, toxic towards our neuron. Cardiac poison, that is, poison for heart tissues. Respiratory poison, poison for our respiratory system or toxic for our respiratory system. And miscellaneous. Okay, so these are the classification of poisons. Based upon their site of action, poison can be classified into corrosives, irritants, neurotoxics, cardiac poisons, respiratory poisons, and miscellaneous. Miscellaneous ones have general rule. Now, poison can also be classified based on medico-legal purpose. Based on medico-legal purpose, poison can be classified as suicidal, knowingly if somebody takes it, homicidal for killing someone if somebody uses this type of poison, accidental, unknowingly swallowing or ingesting or inhaling the poison. Stupefying, that is, dose related adverse effect. I mean, somebody unknowingly or knowingly takes a larger dose of a normal drug which was required for its therapeutic activity. The heavier dose acts as a poison, or the increased dose acts as a poison. Abortifacient, these are drugs are used for causing abortion, yani killing of fetus. Killing the fetus inside the body. Okay, so these are abortifacients. Next, arrow poisons. These are the poisons which are used in a minimal quantity on the arrowheads, and then they are speared. Next, food poisoning, drug dependence. These are the classification of poison based upon their medico-legal purpose. Based upon their medico-legal choices, poison can be classified into the following categories: suicidal, homicidal, accidental, stupefying, abortifacients, arrow poisons, food poisoning, and drug dependence. Now moving on further towards antidote. We had learnt about poison. Poison, what is the poison? What does poison cause? Well, poison is defined as any substance which, when administered, inhaled, or swallowed, leads to deleterious effect towards our body. Okay, unwanted deleterious effect. So, in order to combat this poison, antidotes are available. In order to combat the activity of poison, antidotes are available. What are antidotes? What is meant by an antidote? An antidote is an agent which counteracts the poison. Antidotes are the agents that act against the poison, or they counteract the deleterious effect of poison. Antidotes are defined as a therapeutic substance used to counteract the toxic actions of a specific xenobiotics. Okay, so antidotes are the agents that are used for counteracting the deleterious effect of poison. Removal of poison from the stomach can be done. Okay, this is another a line of action towards treatment of poison, that is removal of poison through emesis by administration of emetics. In our previous class we had discussed about emetics and their role. What does an emetic do? An emetic acts on the vomiting center and initiates vomiting, that is complete removal of any food material or any traces of material from our gut. Okay, so these are emetics. Emetics are also used in poison treatment, as a therapy in poison. They are also used as antidotes. They act by completely removing the poison from our stomach. Now, antidotes has a variety of action. They act in a number of ways. To name a few, if we move on towards noting down or towards elaborating the mechanism of action of poison, then poison acts by complex formation. Poison shows its activity by complex formation. Number two, by metabolic conversion. Number one, a poison acts by complex formation. Number two, a poison can act by metabolic conversion also. Okay, now I'm sorry, antidotes can act by complex formation, antidotes can also act by metabolic conversion. I'm sorry, there was just a mixing of words here. So now moving on further towards classification of antidotes. Now we will see various classes of antidotes. Antidotes can be classified into chemical antidotes, physiological antidotes and mechanical antidotes. Chemical antidotes, physiological antidotes and mechanical antidotes. See, okay, now chemical antidotes, for example, sodium thiosulfate, sodium calcium additate, these are the examples of chemical antidotes. Moving on towards physiological antidotes, we have sodium nitrite. These are physiological antidotes. The explanation about all these three we will see in our upcoming slides. Next, moving on towards mechanical antidotes, for example, activated charcoal. Activated charcoal are the examples for mechanical antidotes. Okay, so according to the mechanism of action, antidotes are classified into complex formation. That means our antidotes forms a complex, a removable or a soluble complex or an insoluble complex with our poison, which can be easily removed out. Okay, that is, it converts our poison into inactive state by complexing with it, so that it can be easily removed out. Otherwise, metabolic conversion, that is, they convert the poison moiety into a form which is non-toxic or less toxic towards our body. Metabolic conversion. Okay, now classification based on chemical types, then they are based upon their activity, they are classified into chemical antidotes, physiological antidotes and mechanical antidotes. Now here in our slide we shall be looking into general treatment for poisoning. What are the various general treatments or general methods for treatment of poisoning? The general treatment for poisoning is given if the specific nature of poison is not known. See, unless and until we know the specific nature of the poison, we cannot determine which of these antidotes to be given. Okay. So in such cases where we don't know what is the poison that is affecting that particular person or that particular substance, we go for general treatment of poisoning. Here we don't have any idea about the type of poison which has been taken. The condition of patient is assessed by detailed clinical examination first. Okay, so before moving on towards general treatment for poisoning, we go for clinically examining the patient. Okay, so the condition of patient is assessed by detailed chemical clinical examination based upon the degree of loss of consciousness and presence or absence of other medical complications. So here, before administering an antidote, we need to look into three things. Number one, how conscious the patient is. Okay, so the degree of consciousness of the patient. Second one, if there is a presence or absence of other medical complexities or other medical complications. So these are the two things which we need to look before going for administration of an antidote. Next, the patient should be removed from the source of exposure first. The degree of loss of consciousness is graded by Reed's classification. Reed's classification describes the degree of loss of consciousness. The degree of coma is assessed by Glasgow Coma Scale. So these terminologies are essential. Reed's classification defines the degree of loss of consciousness, and Glasgow Coma Scale defines the degree of coma. Okay. Now, so with this, we move on towards individual drugs. Okay, that is sodium thiosulfate, sodium nitrite, the ones which has been unactivated charcoal. This has been mentioned in your syllabus. But before moving on towards our drugs, we will again look into briefly into our antidotes. So sodium thiosulfate, sodium nitrite, activated charcoal, all these three drugs belong to the category of antidotes. Okay, they act as antidotes. What are these antidotes? Antidotes are agents which counteract the poison. Antidotes are the agents that are used for counteracting the action of poison. Okay, so antidotes are also defined as therapeutic substances used to counteract the toxic actions of a specific xenobiotic. Removal of poison from the stomach can be done either by emesis or by giving the antidotes. Now, how does this these antidotes act? They either act by complex formation or they act by metabolic conversion. Either they form complex with the poison or they convert the poison's nature. That is metabolic conversion. Now, three of our drugs, sodium nitrite, sodium thiosulfate and activated charcoal, belong to the following category. The chemical antidotes, sodium thiosulfate belongs to the category of chemical antidotes. Sodium nitrite belongs to the category of physiological antidotes. And our activated charcoal belongs to the category of mechanical antidote. So now we will see all these three one by one. Moving on towards sodium thiosulfate. Sodium thiosulfate is also known as, it has got a synonym known as sodium hyposulfite. Sodium thiosulfate is also known as sodium hyposulfite. It has a chemical formula Na2S2O3.5H2O. It has a chemical formula Na2S2O3.5H2O. It has a molecular weight of 248.17 gram per mole. Sodium thiosulfate, which belongs to the category of chemical antidote, has a molecular weight of 248.17 gram per mole. They belong to the category of antioxidant, antidote against cyanide poisoning. Okay, So sodium thiosulfate, first of all, they act as antioxidant. Along with this, they also act as they act against cyanide poisoning. Okay. So these are the categories to which sodium thiosulfate belongs. Now we will move towards preparation of sodium thiosulfate. See, sodium thiosulfate is prepared in three steps. Please look into this in detail. Please look into it carefully. Sodium thiosulfate has a three-step preparation process. It can be prepared in three steps. What are they? Now, sodium in the step 1, preparation of sodium bisulfite. In step 1, sodium bisulfite is prepared first. Okay. So, sodium carbonate reacts with sulfur dioxide. Sodium carbonate or Na2CO3. Sodium carbonate react with sulfur dioxide SO2 in the presence of water. In the presence of water. This leads to formation of sodium bisulfite. Okay. Sodium carbonate in the presence of sulfur dioxide. Sodium carbonate in the presence of sulfur dioxide. In the presence of water forms NaHSO3 plus SO2 plus water leads to NaHSO3, that is sodium bisulfite. If we move on towards balancing the reaction, two sodium atoms, hence two molecules of NaHSO3. So, when sodium carbonate reacts with sulfur dioxide in the presence of water, two molecules of sodium bisulfite is formed with the liberation of carbon dioxide, along with the liberation of carbon dioxide. Next, in step number 2, sodium bisulfite is converted into sodium sulfite. So, step number 2 involves preparation of sodium sulfite. So, what happens in step number 2? Sodium bisulfite is again treated with sodium carbonate to give sodium sulfite. Sodium bisulfite NaHSO3 is again treated with sodium carbonate Na2CO3. This forms 2Na2SO3. 2Na2SO3, also known as sodium sulfite. This reaction again involves release of carbon dioxide and water. Release of carbon dioxide and water. Step number 3. The third step involves preparation of sodium thiosulfate. That means sodium sulfite in the next step is converted into sodium thiosulfate. How does this happen? Sodium sulfite is boiled with powdered sulfur. Na2SO3 or sodium sulfite is then boiled with powdered sulfur. Na2SO3 is again reacted with powdered sulfur to give sodium thiosulfate. Na2SO3 is made to react with sulfur forming Na2S2O3. Na2S2O3 is the product which is formed. So, this is how sodium thiosulfate gets synthesized. A three-step reaction in which step number 1, sodium bisulfite is formed, that is sodium carbonate reacts with sulfur dioxide in the presence of water to form sodium bisulfite. This sodium bisulfite is further made to react with sodium carbonate to form sodium sulfite. This sodium sulfite is further reacted in the presence of sulfur atom to form Na2S2O3 or sodium thiosulfate. Sodium thiosulfate is assayed by using iodometric titration. The assay of sodium thiosulfate can be done by using iodometric titration. Iodometric titration is a single step titration, also known as direct titration method. It is also known as direct titration. what happens in iodometric titration is, we first of all, step number one involves dissolving of 0.8 grams of dried sodium thiosulfate, and it is dissolved in about 30 ml of water. It is made to titrate with 0.1 normal iodine solution. Okay, very simple. Iodometric titration is a single step titration, also known as direct titration. What happens, what are we doing here, what is the mechanism here? Here, our reagent or our starting material or sodium thiosulfate is dissolved in water and it is titrated with 0.1 normal iodine solution. Starch is used as an indicator here. 3 ml starch solution is added towards the end point. It is the indicator. The approach of end point can be recognized by yellow color of iodine, which gets discharged by shaking for a few seconds. So, the reaction which is happening here is sodium thiosulfate Na2S2O3 reacts with iodine molecule I2 to form Na2S4O6 plus 2NaI. Each 0.1 normal iodine is equivalent to 15.81 mg of sodium thiosulfate. Okay, so this is the standardization value. Sodium thiosulfate is coarse and a crystalline powder. It is colorless, odorless and alkaline in taste. They are soluble in water and practically insoluble in alcohol. They are used as antidote in cyanide poisoning. It is used in the treatment of skin infections also. Now moving on towards our next antidote, which is activated charcoal. This is again another form of antidote. Activated charcoal, also known as activated carbon. The chemical name is carbon with a formula of chemical C. It belongs to the category of adsorbent and decolorizing agent. Activated charcoal is obtained from vegetable sources by suitable carbonization and activation of organic matter. Wood, coconut shell, cellulose residues, coal, etc. are burnt in the absence of oxygen at a temperature below 600 degrees Celsius, leads to the formation of activated charcoal. To increase the absorptive power, porosity and surface area of the raw charcoal, it is exposed to carbon dioxide, phosphoric acid, steam or zinc chloride at a temperature between 550 to 900 degrees Celsius. These are the cases. If done, it leads to the increase in porosity, surface area and absorptive power of our compound. The charcoal obtained after activation is termed as activated charcoal. It is a black powder. It has a granular structure, tasteless and odorless. It is insoluble in water and organic solvents. It is used as adsorbent, decolorizing agents and used in poisoning also. Moving on towards our next agent, sodium nitrite. It is an inorganic compound, non-combustible, but accelerate the burning of combustible material. They act as antioxidant that is used to cure meats. Less than 5% of daily nitrite intake comes from cured meats. Nearly 93% of nitrite comes from leafy vegetables and tubers, and our own saliva also generates nitrite. Vegetables contain sodium nitrate, which is converted to nitrite when it comes into contact with saliva in our mouth. There is another source of nitrite in the body, which is nitric acid. It is an amazing chemical that the body uses to control blood pressure, kill tumor cells and heal wounds. It is written as NaNO2, has a molecular weight 69 grams per mole. It is white to slightly yellowish crystalline powder that is very soluble in water. It is hygroscopic in nature. It has a specific odor. The density is 2.186 grams per centimeter cube. Solubility, when we talk about solubility, it is freely soluble in water and soluble in alcohol. It has a melting point of 271 degrees Celsius. It has a pH that lies between 7 and 9. When we talk about the chemical properties, in the laboratory, sodium nitrite can be used to destroy excess sodium azides. Okay, so NaN3, when reacted with sodium nitrite, gives 3N2 plus nitrous oxide plus Na plus plus 2H2O. So excess azides can be removed by using sodium nitrite. Above 330 degrees Celsius, sodium nitrite decomposes in air to form sodium oxide, nitric oxide and nitrogen dioxide. So at a high temperature, NaNO2 decomposes into sodium oxide Na2O, nitric oxide and nitrous oxide. Sodium nitrite can also be used in the production of nitrous acid via sulfuric acid. By using sulfuric acid, nitrous acid can be formed. 2NaNO2 in the presence of sulfuric acid forms nitrous acids. It is prepared, if you look into preparation, then it is prepared by treating sodium hydroxide with mixtures of nitrogen dioxide and nitric oxide. NaOH plus NO2 plus NO gives NaNO2. The conversion is sensitive to the presence of oxygen, which can lead to varying amounts of sodium nitrite. So how can sodium nitrite be prepared? In the presence of sodium hydroxide, nitric oxide, nitrogen dioxide and nitric oxide. Sodium nitrite is used as a part of an intravenous mixture with sodium thiosulfate to treat cyanide poisoning. The compound is toxic and mutagenic and will react in vivo with secondary or tertiary amines, thereby producing highly carcinogenic nitrosamines also. According to healthsafety.org, sodium nitrite works with sodium chloride or salts to inhibit the growth of Clostridium botulinum. It is an organism that causes fatal food poisoning. Sodium nitrite is also effective against Listeria monocytogenes. Sodium nitrite also shows promising activity in the treatment of high blood pressure, kidney failure, heart disease and organ damage. In oxygen poor tissues, nitrite can convert into nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is a chemical that dilates our blood vessels to enhance blood flow. It acts as an antidote. Sodium nitrite promotes formation of methemoglobin, which combines with cyanide to form non-toxic cyanomethemoglobin. So this is how our sodium nitrite acts as an antidote. Other actions are, they produce vasodilation by relaxing vascular muscles and smooth muscles. So with this, we come to an end of our class. I hope this was helpful to all of you. Thank you.